trouble may surround me, my heart may fail, but you never will. You never will.
Good morning, everybody. Yeah, that's pretty good for Wednesday. I like that. I actually got a good morning back, not just morning. What we are going to do, as we have done every day, I know we all have sleep in our eyes. I didn't bring my contact stuff, so I actually have like literal sleep, eye crusties, boogers, whatever you want to call them, in my eyes that I need to get out, maybe sweat out even, hopefully not. But I need to get out of my eyes. I need to stretch a little bit. My back's hurting a little bit from Ultimate Frisbee because I'm getting a little bit older. All right, I need to stretch out, warm up my muscles so they don't hurt for a little bit. So that's what we've been doing every morning, getting you up and getting you moving. And our first song today, I hopefully will do that. We're going to do You Lifted Me Out this morning, so prepare. There is some dancing. There is some owing. There are some various other elements that you need to include. If you know this song, if you know the motions, you're more than welcome to come up here, help out Shelby. She'll be dancing. She'll be owing as well as I will.
Set me dancing. Now I am free. Your love rescued me.
set me dancing, dancing free. Now I am free. Your love rescued me. Now it's the anthem I sing. Yeah. Oh, 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 oh,
waited for this day.
We waited for this day. We've gathered in your name, calling out to you. With glory like a fire, awakening desire, our hearts will burn with truth. Oh, your love. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens. We want to see you. Open up the floodgates. A mighty river flowing from your heart. This place, your glory on our face, you're looking to the sky, descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now, Lord, unfill our eyes. You're the reason we're here, you're the reason we're seeing.
see, I was in a really, really deep pool until I saw my life flash before my eyes as I began to drown to my death. What happened next? Well, I'm not sure how to explain it, really. All I know is that I didn't deserve any of it.
Duncan, do you believe Jesus is Lord?
Yes!
Do you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead?
Yes!
Never swim without a lifeguard on duty. That is the big man.
Nice and relaxing.
If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Romans 10:9. Initially, before Duncan received that life jacket, if he would have kept wailing and flailing about and freaking out, he would have drowned. He would have died. In the bathtub, I know. Now, our lives work exactly the same way. Oftentimes, we dismiss the urgency that comes with declaring he is Lord and following God's commandments. We get so consumed with our own rebellion, pride, selfishness, whatever your Baal of that time may be, that time, that semester, that moment, that minute, we too will drown. So friends, I encourage you, do not miss the parade. Declare he is Lord before your heart, your lungs, fill with water. So let's read our verse together twice. If you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Romans 10:9. And again, if you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you too will be saved. Romans 10:9. All right, now with blanks. If you declare with your heart, or Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Romans 10:9. And one more time, all together with no blanks. If you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Romans 10:9. Don't miss that parade.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I would like to ask all of the 2015 quizzers to please take the stage. Arkansas Companions with Michigan Companion, Arkansas Messengers, This from Minnesota, and Things. Please welcome them to the stage with a round of applause and... At this time, we do want to present trophies to our first, second, and third place teams. In third place, we had the Arkansas Messengers. If you guys will go see Stephanie, Arkansas Messengers. In second place, This from Minnesota. And in first place, Things from Virginia. In addition to team trophies and rewards, recognition, thank you. We do recognize individual performance as well. So we're going to announce the first or the top 10 quizzers of 2015. If I call your name and you're seated 10 through 6, if you would just step forward and if you would hold your applause until 10 through 6 have been announced. In 10th chair, we have Colby Leggett. In 9th chair, Cameron Landry. In 8th chair, Harrison Goodrich. 7th chair, Haley Goodrich. 6th chair, Jeffrey Siders. And the top 5, in addition to just your applause, they're going to receive a trophy that Steph is going to hand to them, and then they're going to pose for a picture right there with John, and they're also going to receive an Amazon gift card of varying values. So let me put those on the table. In 5th chair, from Arkansas Messengers, Ryan Leggett. Good job, Ryan. In 4th chair, from this, Mason Landry. In 3rd chair, from Things, Jared Siders. In 2nd chair, from this, Nathaniel Johnson. And in 1st chair, described by our 2nd chair All-Star team member, the Beast, from Things, Jordan Fletcher. Put your hands together one more time for our quizzers from 2015. And I'm going to ask the quizzers to stay on the stage. Atlanta Bible College has a special announcement for all of you. Did anybody remember what you're supposed to do when ABC comes up?
Thank you, Chris. Thank you. Come on, a little bit louder. Come on. Come on, a little louder. Yeah. Woo. Hey, thank you. Guys, guess what? It's not over. That's not all you're going to receive. We're going to be giving you some money. Who wants some money? Oh, you don't want it? Who wants some money? Yeah. All right. Anyway, look, Atlanta Bible College would like to present to all of our quizzers today a certificate, and each quizzer will receive a free class at Atlanta Bible College. Come on, somebody, give it up for them. All right, all right. And for the top 5 quizzers, Atlanta Bible College will give you a $500 scholarship. Come on, guys, give it up. Yes, yes. And so even though some of you guys are too young right now to come to the Bible College, it doesn't matter, because guess what? When you graduate from high school, you get that certificate and you present it to the Bible College, and you still get your free class or your $500 scholarship. Okay? We want to say thank you and congratulations. Kim is going to call you out and hand you your certificates, and then from there you can proceed off the stage.
What about those? This
is going to be the top.
Okay.
5.
John Evans.
I'll pull you into the top.
Good
5.
Job. Harrison Goodrich.
Okay. You can go ahead and sit down.
Ryan Leggett. Herbie Evans. Marissa Swanson. James Griffith. If I said that wrong, sorry. Colby Leggett. Haley Goodrich. Casey Joe Fletcher. Thank you. Jeffrey Siders? Jared Siders? Yeah, sorry. Jordan Fletcher? Jeremiah Smead? Cameron Landry? Mason Landry? Nathan Johnson? All right. Thanks, everybody. Okay.
All right, and these are our top five right here. These guys right now. Come on, everybody give it up for our top five quizzers. Yeah! Ow! All right. These guys are going to receive $500, a $500 scholarship to Atlanta Bible College. It's awesome. And I'm telling you right now, guys, I'm looking forward to seeing every last one of you there as soon as you graduate from high school. Kim, call them out.
Okay, Jordan Fletcher, running out of room. Nathaniel Johnson. Jared Siders. Mason Landry. And Ryan Leggett.
All right, one more time, give it up for the top five. All right. Ow! ABC, 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 ABC. Thank you, guys.
All right, everybody. Hello and good morning. Thank you, Jay. All right. So, I'm here to talk to you about ABC just for another couple seconds. Whenever you guys are ready to go, I'm ready to go. So I have a little PowerPoint prepared for you on priorities and how we spend our time and our life, just to give you a little perspective on what we do and what we spend our time on. As soon as that PowerPoint is up, I'll tell you. Okay. I'm trying to think of some good jokes, but I'm just not funny. Okay, no joke. There's this sixth grader who told me a joke. It was the funniest thing ever, but I can't remember it. It was a knock-knock joke. Are we ready? Are we good to go? No? What? How many tickles does it take to tickle an octopus? Okay, so we're talking about priorities. Okay, go to the first slide. We're going to get back down to business. Okay, so the average American lives about 80 years, okay? So during that time, they spend roughly 23 years sleeping, right? 23 and a half years of your life is spent sleeping. Go ahead to the next slide. On average, 10.4 years of that American's life is spent doing nothing but working. All right. 4.3 years of your life is spent nothing but sitting in a car, driving to a place. Go ahead. 3.6 years of your life is spent eating. Accumulated time. Okay, yes. Everybody likes that one. That is time well spent. All right. 2.5 years of your life is spent cooking the food on top of the 3.6 years of the life you spend eating it. All right. 1.1 years of your life are spent cleaning, and not to be crude, but 92 days of your life is spent sitting on a toilet. All right, so the question is, how much time would you spend if you came to the Bible College? If you came for two semesters, the accumulated time you spent working and doing actual Bible College stuff would be only 35 days. Only 35 days of your life would be spent going through the Atlanta Bible College. And now, I'm not here to guilt trip you, because I know the Bible College isn't for everyone. But just think about your priorities a little bit. Where is your time spent? You can go ahead to the next slide. Is that 35 days of your life, do you think that's spent well? If it's spent growing closer to God, 35 days of your life is spent building a foundation for the rest of your life? I would say that is time very well spent.
And it's definitely better than the 1.5 years spent cleaning, because that's just dumb. I hate cleaning. So, go ahead to the next slide. If you would, please. Not to mention, there's free tuition if you qualify. All right, so not only is it only going to be 35 days of your time, but it could be almost entirely free if you qualify for free tuition. So there's almost no reason not to go, and you're not going to be putting your life on hold because it's only 9 months. Out of your 80 years, it's not that much time. All right? You're going to have the rest of your life to do whatever you want. And this 35 days isn't just knowledge that you're going to use one time and then get rid of. It's knowledge that will literally last forever, and that is something that most schools can't give you. Because when you're in the kingdom with God, you're going to know him that much better from the time you spent at the Bible college. And I'm not discouraging you from going other places and doing other things with your life, but I'm just saying it's a really good option. And if you decide to take this one-year challenge, if you go up to the booth, there's these papers that look like this, and it shows requirements and goals and things, and I'm not exactly sure because I didn't read all of it. Honestly, I have no idea what's on it. So if you go up there and look at it, you'll know more than me about the one-year challenge, and then you'll be smarter than me, and you can come teach me how to do Bible stuff at the Bible college. I hope to see you there.
All right, guys, I want to share a few quick announcements with you real fast here. The ABC Scholarship Content Test is coming up this afternoon. That's in the Science Center 104, and that's during recreation time at 3:15. You'll probably forget, so I will remind you again right before rec time. Also, there is an offering tonight and tomorrow night for fuel scholarships. And just as a reminder, because of the giving that happened last year, which I believe we said was $2,600, 17 people were able to be here this week. So, praise God. Praise God. There is a lost phone in the fuel office. So if you lost your phone, go to the fuel office and see if it's yours. Another problem that we're having, and I just want to make you aware of this, is in the common areas, they have been saying that there has been a lot of trash left over, and a lot of people are just leaving their things around. Your mama's not here, not that your mama cleans up after you anyway, but because she shouldn't be. You should be cleaning up your own stuff, but so shame on you. But you need to be picking up your stuff and be a good witness, okay? That'll be very, very good. One last announcement. If Aaron told you or you want to participate in the Thursday afternoon student-led worship session, meet on the stage after this morning session. Okay? Okay? Yeah, all right. I can't see anybody, so I'd assume you're out there. All right, I think that's it.
Stand and sing with me. Joy unspeakable, faith unsinkable, love unstoppable. Anything is possible.
Joy unspeakable, faith unsinkable, love unstoppable. Anything is possible. Joy unspeakable, faith unsinkable, love unstoppable, anything is possible.
Here in this morning we land, where many a dream has died. Like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts, fill our souls with one desire, just to know you and to make you know me.
Let your name on high shine like the sun makes darkness running in high. We know a babe was so much more than ordinary life. It's time for us to do more than just into your word we're digging deep to know our Father's heart. Into the world we're reaching out to show them who you are. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst one more of you. Fill our hearts, fill our souls with what we desire, just to know you and to make you know me. Lift your name on high, shine like the sun makes darkness running high. We know we're made for so much more. It's time for us to hold and just survive. We were made to thrive.
Joy unspeakable, church, sing it.
Oh, joy unspeakable, faith unspeakable, love unstoppable. Possible joy, unspeakable faith, unsinkable love, unstoppable. Anything is possible. Joy, unspeakable faith, unsinkable love, unstoppable. Anything is possible. Joy. Shine like the sun, make darkness run and hide. We know we're made for so much more than ordinary life. It's time for us to do more than just survive. Yeah, your grace, oh God's the anchor that's holding me forever. Come trouble or high water, I am steadfast. Yeah, you lift me when I'm sinking, like the swells of mighty oceans. The power of redemption, yeah, it gives me wings to soar.
God, we lift up the chorus of this song to you, letting it be our prayer this morning, that our souls cry out to you, holy, because we want to be in your holy presence, that our hearts are lost in your beauty because you're such an amazing God, that all hope is found. We are putting our hope and trust in you because you are the anchor, as this song says. We cast our crowns before you, knowing that the way we live our lives, though we may think we have it right, we immediately find out, either by consequences or by experience or whatever comes along, that your way is the only way. Your way is the perfect way. Your way is beyond and above what we can fathom. And sometimes we just get little pieces of that where you have shown us, I told you so. God, I don't want to wait for I told you so moments to follow you. I want to just follow you because I know your way is great. Your way is perfect. And you have the best interests of me and us and everyone here in your thoughts. We pray for the strength, for the turn, for the word, whatever it is that will make us follow you and turn our eyes to you for the rest of our lives. Pray these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Good morning. Anyone ever wake up and get on facial or get on Facebook or social media or Twitter or Instagram or the news and start to watch a story that catches your attention? It's like a need-to-know story, like somebody you know or something from your hometown, and I just like you got to find out what is going on here. Not long ago, I saw such a story, and maybe it's because I'm a mom, maybe it's because I'm a nurse, maybe it's because I'm nosy. It was like a need-to-know story for me. And here's what happened in Ohio. A gentleman, 27-year-old from Cincinnati, went hiking with some of his buddies, three buddies. So they go hiking in a national forest in Kentucky, the Red River Gorge, and they're off to have just a fun trip. And they hike along, and it's beautiful, and they find a place to camp. And they set up camp, and I'm sure, like all of us, they stay up late talking, and about midnight, they lay down. And so this gentleman, this 27-year-old Ryan, he has a hammock. So he lays in his hammock, which I think is so super cool. And they're laying there and, you know, under the stars. And about an hour later, Ryan gets out of his hammock and he starts to kind of stumble around. Ryan has a history of sleepwalking, okay? So he starts stumbling around and his buddies see him, and he's kind of like walking close to a cliff, and his friends say, "Dude, Ryan, dude," and he actually talked back to them briefly, but he was still sleepwalking, and he walked right off the ledge and fell 60 feet. That's six stories. People don't survive when they fall that far. But he was saved by a tree that was growing out the side of this cliff and knocked unconscious. And it's 1 o'clock in the morning now, and his friends can't see him. It's foggy, it's late, and they're yelling at him, and they don't know if he's alive or dead. And they call for rescue. They're in a forest. It took 3 hours for any rescuers to find the location, another hour for them to rappel down to him. In the meantime, he regained consciousness and was alive, which was a miracle in itself. He had a broken leg, and he had facial injuries and a dislocated shoulder. I mean, what a miracle, he is alive. But he was clinging to this tree for dear life while they rappelled down to get him and got a basket and made it all so he could safely come up, because they didn't know if he had a broken neck. They had no idea. And so they finally, you know, get him back up and get him to the hospital. I just am like blown away. He was released like the same day, which just absolutely blows my mind, 60 feet. And just miraculously lived. But the rescuer, I have to read you this quote because, like, seriously, holy smokes. Here's the quote. "He has a history of sleepwalking. So camping on the cliff ledge, that's probably what led to the incident." Really? Seriously? That doesn't take rocket science. And so the thing was, I kind of, you know, this was a need-to-know story for me because it had injury, it had all these things going on. I had to know what was happening. And so I kept watching to see, what is this guy going to say? I mean, this is crazy. And Ryan, the 27-year-old, his quote was, "You'll never have to come rescue me again. I will never let that happen again. I won't put myself in that position." So how many times, you guys, do we see our friends and our family stumbling around a little too close to the ledge, and we know they're not safe? We know we probably ought to say more than "dude," right? But we kind of watch it all unfold. How many times do we personally hang out a little too close to the ledge and then say, I'll never You'll never have to rescue me again. I'll never put myself in this position again. And yet, there we go. Back to the ledge. And we know it's a temptation, or it's a place maybe we shouldn't be hanging out. Maybe we shouldn't be getting that close. Some people don't have a problem with gossip or pride or this temptation. Some people do. How many times do we just keep sneaking towards that ledge? Well, let me just suggest that in this story, we all fall somewhere, all of us. You know, we're hikers on this journey. We're out to enjoy life, absolutely. But we're either friends with our buddy who's stumbling around, not making the best decisions, a little too close to the ledge, or we're that person, maybe, you know, just checking it out again, a little too close to the ledge, and maybe we need to listen to the wise counsel that's around us. Or maybe we are hanging onto that tree for dear life, waiting to be rescued. We're all somewhere within that story. So, fortunately, we have a great instruction manual from God, and I always appreciate learning from other people's mistakes. I mean, yes, you learn from your own mistakes, clearly, but why not learn from somebody else's mistakes? So, we're going to look at two people in the Bible, a believer and a non-believer, because really, that's how we show up, and that's who we see here. We see believers, we see people that, you know, grew up in the church, they've known God all their life, they accepted Jesus. And then we've got non-believers that are just kind of watching us, watching our witness, maybe listening to our counsel, maybe. And we need to be the wise counsel that comes up around them and does a little more than just yells, "Dude, what are you doing?" And so the first person I want to look at is King David. And I know that he's been mentioned multiple times. I love him. He has a passionate mess of a life, but I just love him because he is passionate. And he, you know, he's first of all, is a man after God's own heart. So, you know, we read that in the Old Testament and we read that in the New Testament. I know a lot of people say, "Oh, that's all Old Testament stuff," but, you know, again, in the New Testament, he was a man after God's own heart. So you have to realize, I mean, God knows our hearts, and he sees the whole person. And so here's David, and he starts out, and I know a lot of you know his story. He's, first of all, an obedient son. He's a hard worker. He is reliable. You know, he's a shepherd. And he really takes control of his own life as far as training himself. You know, he learns to protect his sheep. You know, he kills a lion and a bear with his bare hands, which, oh my gracious. But also is skilled with a sling and a stone. He goes out, as we know, he kills who? Goliath. And not only does he kill him, but he has the faith to go against him. And, you know, and proceeds to, he's a musician, he's a poet. He is a true worshiper of his God. And, you know, eventually ends up running from King Saul. You know, he's anointed. He's going to be the second king of Israel, of God's people. Thank you, Bob, for talking to us about God's people, about the Israelites. But in the meantime, he's got King Saul, who, you know, is cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs, because he just thinks, I need to be king forever, and I need to do away with him. And he's, you know, chasing him down, and poor David. But David's so resourceful. He, you know, pretends to be a madman for a while. He hangs out with the Philistines and pretends to be on their team for a while, and until he finally, at age 30, gets to be king. So finally, you know, he's appointed, anointed place. God wanted him to be king of his people of Israel. He's the second king. He's 30 years old, which, you know, how cool is that? Jesus started his ministry when he was 30 years old. But here's David on the throne, and he does great things. He, you know, bigger army, more land, more money, all those things. But about 10 years later, you know, he starts to get kind of comfortable and maybe a little full of himself, and to the point where he starts to get a little close to the ledge where I told you he's a passionate person. He's passionate in everything that he does. And he decides, you know, I know this time of year kings go out and go to war with their army, but I've done a lot of work here. I've done a great job. I should have a vacation. I mean, I should take some time off. I should do whatever I want to do. And so instead of doing what he knows he needs to do, he does whatever he wants to do. So we read in 2 Samuel 11:1-2. In the spring, at the time when kings go off to war, David, he sends his whole army. He sends Israel, God's army, and he remains back in Jerusalem. He decides, you know what? I don't need to do that. I know I should do that, but I don't think I'm going to do that. And so he stays back. Ironically, he's laying down in the evening. You remember our hiker, our camper? He's laying down in his hammock. He gets out of his hammock. He's stumbling around. Here's David in the evening when he's not doing what he should be doing. He's laying down. He's taking it easy. It's the evening time. And in 2 Samuel 11:2, we read, one evening, David got up from bed and walked around the roof of the palace. From the roof, he saw a woman bathing. How much do we wear when we're bathing? Nothing. So David ought to go, whew, I'm a passionate guy and I'm on the ledge. I should probably go back and maybe read about the time I saw King Saul taking a dump in the cave, but no. You know, you really need to get your brain somewhere else. You need to go, okay, what can I do? What can I think about? What can I go occupy my brain with? Because right now my brain sees a naked woman, right? And should he be looking at a naked woman? That's not his wife. No. He's married. She's married. Now, what he does is, I mean, he's the king, he can do whatever he wants, but he calls some guys together. Let me suggest, this is his wise counsel, right? So here's our guys. Well, here's David, actually. Here's David looking at the beauty, sitting a little too close to the ledge. Oh, it's so beautiful. I think I'll just hang out here for a while. I don't think I'll do what I should be doing. I think I'll just enjoy God's beauty with no clothes. And so he calls his men, though. So his men, you know, a lot of them are where he should be. They are out with the army. But he calls a couple guys, and he says, can you go find out about this girl for me? Now here's his wise counsel. And you see David, he's like, oh, I'm walking off the ledge. I've got tunnel vision. I see a naked woman. But his buddies are like, isn't that the daughter of Eliam, which is probably a friend of David's, by the way. And isn't that the wife of Uriah the Hittite, which was actually in David's royal army, his royal guard? And David knows this. And that's, you know, that's their, dude, stop. You know, isn't that, you know, your friend's daughter? Isn't that the wife of, like, put on the brakes, David. And David's king. And David does what he wants to do. And David makes a bad choice. And David walks right on off the cliff, even though they're like, hold on. You're staggering around, buddy. He walks right off the cliff. He says, get her for me. So they get her for him. He sleeps with her. And shocker, she's pregnant. And it is 100% David's. There's no question. And she sends word to David, David, I'm pregnant. So now, you know, as Rebecca talked about, we go into game plan mode. I got to fix this. You know, I'm going to sew the fig leaves together. What am I going to do? I've got to cover my sin. And David knew it was wrong, but he still, you know, I got to fix this. And you know what? Kings do a lot of problem solving. in reality, you know, his brain goes straight to, what can I do to fix this? Not, boy, I screwed up. And so he decides, well, what can I do? So he tries multiple times to get Uriah, which is Bathsheba's, the naked woman he saw, her husband, to come back. Come back! Sleep with your wife! We'll pretend it's your baby. You'll never know. You know? And Uriah was such a man of God, such a hard worker, so thoughtful and respectful of what he was set out to do at that time. He wouldn't go home and have the comforts of home. And David kept trying, and he tried multiple times. Go home. Sleep with your wife. Have some fun. Here's some stuff. Here's some alcohol. Here's some food. He wouldn't do it. And so now David's like scrambling. What am I going to do? I got to fix this. This is bad. What am I going to do? So he devises another plan, a worse plan. And he basically sends Uriah off to be killed. Now David is a murderer. I mean, he sends Uriah to the front of the line, has the army pull back. You know, not only, it's heartbreaking to me to see this man after God's own heart who's so passionate. Not only does he, you know, commit adultery and he covets her and he has Uriah killed, but you know what? That's God's army. That's God's chosen people, the Israelites. Some of them were killed also for no reason, to cover a sin. And so eventually, you know, David has now committed some of the worst, you know, sins you can commit as you read through the Old Testament. And eventually he's going to have to come to his senses. Now here's the question. Can he be saved? Can he be redeemed? Has he done too much? He walked off the cliff. We watched him do it. He staggered around out of bed and off he went. I desire this. I want this. I don't care what you say, God. I'm going for it. Now I'm going to cover it up. Ooh, I think I'm going to do these other crazy things. Can he be saved? Can he be redeemed? Absolutely he can. The salvation story is easy peasy. I mean, it is so simple, and we have to repent. And that's what David finally does. And for some good reading for all of you that have never read the part about Nathan coming to him, which I just love, later on you can read 2 Samuel 12. But David comes to his senses, and he humbles himself, and he falls to his knees, and he asks God for forgiveness. And he says, have mercy on me. Cleanse me. Give me a pure heart. He's broken, and he truly is sorry, and God knows his heart. This isn't like, I'm sorry I got caught. We have that sometimes, don't we? I'm sorry, if that's what you want to hear. He was truly, truly sorry. And so as we read through his story, you know, we read, Seth talked about, you know, Hebrews 11, the faith chapter. He is in the faith chapter. He's listed there. Not only is he listed there, he, you know, Jesus is a descendant of his. Jesus is called the son of David. Jesus, you know, is going to sit on David's throne, but the Star of David is on the flag of Israel to this day. So, yes, he can be forgiven. He is forgiven. God is the God of second chances, for sure. Rebecca Dox is covered. We all sin, you know. We are all sinners. We all fall short of the glory of God, which is Romans 3:23. Now, let's look at a non-believer. We've got Captain Naaman. Some of you know his story. He is a national hero. He is like second in command to the king. Now here's the thing, it's the king of the bad guys. And so he doesn't believe in God. He's got just about everything you would want, money and power and prestige and honor, but he also has a disease. He has leprosy. And so we've got Captain Naaman, and he's hanging on that branch. He's hanging on for dear life because it doesn't matter how much money you have if you're going to die. And leprosy back then, not curable, isolation, nothing you could do about it. And there he hangs like, I need help. And his wise counsel came in the form of a little servant girl. This is a girl, an Israelite, one of God's people, that had been captured, and she was the servant of his wife. And she said, hey, there's a guy in Israel that could help you. There's a God of Israel that could help you. Why don't you go be cleansed? And he listened to that. Now he goes to the king of Israel, who's not a great witness and doesn't really know what to tell him. He kind of freaks out, but eventually gets to Elisha, which we heard about Elijah last night, but Elisha, who came after him. And Elisha doesn't come out to meet him and say, oh, you're so great, you're a national hero. He sends his servant out, Gehazi. Gehazi says, Elisha says, you need to go to the Jordan. You need to dip 7 times. I know a lot of you know that story. You'll be cleansed. And Naaman said, gross. The Jordan River is disgusting. Well, there's a lot of better rivers. Like, are you kidding me? I thought you were going to wave your hands over me. Where's Elisha anyway? I thought he was going to call on his God. I was going to be cleansed. And his wise counsel, I so appreciate. The men that were with him, they didn't go, oh, just listen to him. They showed him respect. They were courteous. They said, my father, why don't you try this? And so he does. He goes to the Jordan. He dips 7 times. He comes up. He's cleansed. He's not only cleansed from his disgusting, ugly leprosy, he's cleansed from the inside out. He finds out who the real God is, who the God of Israel is. And, you know, when God looks at us and looks at our sin, it shows up pretty ugly. We can cover it up really nice when we're here with our cute clothes and our nice hair and our makeup. But he can see the greed and the envy and the pride. He can see all that, and it's not pretty. And a lot of us need a good cleansing. And Naaman's story is such a beautiful picture of what Jesus later shows us in this same river. He shows us how to be baptized, how to have our sins washed away. So simple. You dip, you accept Jesus as your Savior. You're baptized, your sins are washed away. You are cleansed. And so my question to you is, What kind of friend are you? What kind of counsel are you providing for people? Are you looking over the edge and going, sorry about your luck, buddy? You know, I could imagine this servant girl. She was taken from her family. She, I'm sure, had people she knew killed, maybe her own family. Now she's living as a captive. And she doesn't tell Naaman, you're going to die, you deserve it, dude. She says, hey, there's a God that can heal you. There's a God that can cleanse you. Are we the person that's like, come on back. You're a little close to the ledge. I know you struggle with that. You know, come on back. This is a really beautiful hike, but come on back. Or, you know, where are we in that lineup? I want to talk just briefly about something Michael Sisler has been teaching, if you've been in his class yet. I want you to think about this for a minute, okay? If you go to a doctor and he runs blood work and he does a scan and he does a biopsy and he finds cancer, okay? And he says to you, well, you look good. You're in good health. Enjoy your life. Okay. Interesting. And then you go for a second opinion, and the second doctor does the blood work, does the scan, does the biopsy, and says, "Ooh, Nikki, we found cancer, and it's bad. But we have something that can actually cure this cancer. We need to be diligent here. We need to take some time, and we need to take some energy, and we need to deal with this. We need to treat this. And I know it's not going to be easy, and it's not going to be pretty, but we need to deal with this so that you can, you know, sacrifice a little fun right now so that you can live. Okay, so who's showing the wise counsel, number one or number two in this scenario? The world's teaching us to be tolerant. To be tolerant. You know, the government says it's okay, so it's probably okay. Right? That's not wise counsel. The Bible tells us wise counsel, and we're learning from that. And so as we're on this journey, as we're hiking with our friends, we need to know right from wrong. Redemption's just waiting for us. Salvation's just waiting for us. We just need to accept. But as we're traveling along, there's so many big cliffs, and we need to be the ones to help our friends and our family to hold them back from the ledge that's not safe for them personally, and to let them know right from wrong. You know, sometimes I don't even know there's a cliff there. I'm just walking right on off because somebody told me it continues on forever. That's not true. You need to listen to wise counsel. And so, remember back to our story, Ryan, our hiker. When he fell off the cliff, what saved him? A tree. The same thing that saves you and me. Jesus died on a tree. He died on a cross. For our sins, he paid the price. We don't have to come like Naaman with our big bag of money and try and buy our salvation. It's been paid for. We just have to accept. We just have to accept Jesus as our Savior. And we're redeemed. We've got salvation right there. It's so simple. So, as we look at all of these need-to-know stories, you guys, this is a need-to-know story, and it's a need-to-share story. So, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I'm just so grateful for this group that you have put together here, Lord. I just pray that we can be mindful and diligent of what we need to personally do to be the wise counsel for those who believe in those who are trying to figure out what's going on here, and they may or may not be a believer yet. Lord, I just pray that we can help kind of pull those guys up that need rescued and get them back so they can enjoy your beauty and enjoy the hike that we're on, Lord. We just love and praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If you'll stand with us, this redemption is something that we have been assured and we live out in our lives. Oh, it is the assurance in things we do not see, in death that those before us are waiting patiently. That is why we are here, and we earnestly see a God who would fashion the strong from the weak. We believe, 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 we believe it is. It is the assurance in things we do not see, in death that those before us are waiting patiently. That is why we are here, and we earnestly see a God who would fashion the strong from the weak. That is how we can know, though we cannot comprehend, what
The universe was formed by a God's command. Like everything before our eyes, made from the unseen. That is how we know what's waiting for us in the coming of our King. Strong from the weak, that is how we can know, though we cannot comprehend, that the universe is formed by our God's command. Like everything before our eyes, made from the unseen, that is how we know what's waiting for us when the coming of our King.
Heart
that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in all of us. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in all of us.
All of the earth.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. And great are you, Lord.
No.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. Bones will see. Great are you, Lord. And all of the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will see.
Heavenly Father, you are a God of love and justice, mercy and grace. We pray that you keep moving through this room and that you move throughout the world. Heavenly Father, I pray that you open up our hearts and that we can feel your spirit, receive your spirit, that we're receptive to it. And not only that we're receptive to it, but that you give us the boldness to act on it. God, we love you so much, but we can't even fathom how much more you love us. And it's in your holy, precious Son's name I pray. Amen. If you guys would take a second to look up at the globe. Before today, the globe was painted very precisely, very neatly. But as you can see now, there's a lot of words such as victim, hope, reconciliation, broken chains, survivors. And we might not see the effects of our pleas to God personally in our world, but we all know that God knows and he hears. God listens, God speaks, and God acts. And you all had a part in changing this world. It might not look as pretty. It might not be as neat and well packaged as we first thought the world was. But I think that's a good thing. So as we walk to class, I want you to walk with minds a little more educated, with bodies more bold, and with hearts closer to the heart of God. So go ahead. Walk on. You're dismissed to class.